Hi, I'm B from Nectar Mechanics, and in today's video, we're going to be making a 3D printed Ravage toy whose cassette mode actually plays music? So long-time viewers of the channel will know that this isn't the first time I've tried making a working cassette tape transformer. About a year ago or so, I tried making Laserbeak for the first time using an actual cassette tape for the internal components, and its sound quality was not great and was inconsistent. People who follow my community tab will then know that I tried doing it a second time about 6 months later. The sound quality was somehow worse, and I ended up just giving up on this idea for a while. Until I discovered car stereo adapter tapes. On the Laserbeak tapes, I would have to figure out how to fit two spools, make sure the tape doesn't get pulled or stretched in weird ways. It was a mess, there was so much to keep track of. But these tapes? It is literally a bit of metal connects to a wire. The rest of the shell is superfluous, which means I have a lot more space to fit transformer joints. So I'm very excited to try this out. The first thing I need to do is make sure that I can actually 3D print a shell that will house the new components and work. Ehan Makes on Thingiverse has made a replacement cassette shell for normal cassettes. I used it on Laserbeak and it's a great model. So basically I filled it in so it's a solid block with the correct proportions, and then I cut out a slot for the new components inside. It's basically just two giant rectangles with a hole in the middle. So after a rough test print, I did a dry fit with the new components, put it in the player, and it was sounding great. So now that we know that my replacement shell works, I can start cutting it up into a transformer. So I did lots of different sketches trying to figure out where parts might be able to fit, not necessarily being one-to-one accurate with the proportions or anything, just trying to get stuff from my brain onto the screen. Once I was happy with the sketches, it was time to start 3D modeling them. Now for this project, I'm using Tinkercad. It's a Boolean-based software, which means that you have basic building blocks that you can merge and change the dimensions of, but you can also use those blocks as almost cookie cutters on each other. So I imported the cassette model I'd made so I knew what the dimensions were, and I started doing the basic building blocks inside those dimensions. We're not going to worry about detailing it to look like the cassette till the very end. For now, we're just trying to make sure the dimensions are correct and that the joints work. Now this time-lapse makes it look pretty easy, but Tinkercad is a strange one. It's very beginner friendly, but it's also only really meant for beginner projects. The stuff I'm doing with the precision of the millimeters and stuff, it can do it, but it doesn't like it. So it was an awful lot of faff trying to make sure everything lined up just right. Thankfully, I'm going for a G1 aesthetic, so I can leave an awful lot of it looking blocky and that's fine. For things that are more detailed though, like the head, I decided to just build it separate and add it in later. It was being too much of a pain trying to line it up as I went. For his head sculpt, I wanted to do the thing that every Ravage seems to have, which is that it's either 50% dog, 50% cat. They can't decide what he is. I mean, he's supposed to be a cat originally, but I mean, he barks in the Bumblebee movie, so I don't know. Another thing for the head sculpt is that in my sketches, because it has to fit within the dimensions of the tape, you're gonna see the head silhouette in the side of the tape. I don't mind having the outline. That's fine. A lot of Transformers do that. That's cool. What I do dislike on an awful lot of Ravage toys and models I see is that he's got the two little beady eyes sticking out the side of the tape. And I figured there's gotta be a way to fix that. So I went back to my sketches and designed a mechanism where the eyes are almost on a stalk that slides up, spins, slides back down, and because it's the same measurements all the way around, it lines up perfectly every time and lets me basically spin and swap the color eyes round. So one side can be the same color as the tape, and the other side can be bright red for the cat mode. It's an unnecessary detail, and most people probably wouldn't have cared, but for me, it bugged me, and I managed to find a fix, and that makes me very happy. So, after about a week's worth of modeling and getting all the measurements about right, it was time to actually detail it like the tape, and this is where that Boolean system comes into play really nicely. The easiest way I can explain it is it's like a sort of Play-Doh mold, yeah? You make a shape that you like, you make a mold of it that's like a hard shell, then that shell is the invert of the shape. Then you get something else like fresh clay, stamp it over, and it's got the same shape as the first one. The reason this is beneficial here is that I can basically make a mold of the cassette and then stamp all the individual pieces with that mold so that they have the perfect contour and detailing of the tape. So now that everything's designed, it's time to do a print! Surprisingly, it didn't take very long, only a couple hours. I guess because the parts are so small and thin to fit in the tape mode. Now, most of the parts tolerances right off the bed were a bit too tight. So instead of trying to force it and snap it like I've done a laser beak before, I figured let's just get straight to sanding. Now, I'm also using wood filler to fill in some of the layer lines. This isn't going to be perfect, but it's going to look a little nicer than just a raw print. Now, whenever you're doing sanding, make sure you're wearing a mask so that you don't breathe in dust particles, ideally eye protection if you have it, and also outside in a well-ventilated area. Now, I ended up spending over a day's worth just sanding. I don't like sanding. This sucked. But eventually, the parts were basically certain enough that I could start doing dry fitting, and everything seemed to work nicely. So all the pieces are basically fitting now, so it's time to start painting! Now, an awful lot of him is black, and it's unfortunate that I couldn't have just used the black filament from the get-go, but all of that wood filler and sanding was discoloring it. Thankfully, black acrylic just adheres and covers really nicely to this, but I did want him to have like a greyish-white label. See, most cassette tapes have like a plastic shell with then like a sticker or a label on the front. Now on Laserbeak, I tried doing this two different ways on both versions. The first one, I used stickers that I made, and they didn't adhere very well to the plastic. The second Laserbeak I did, I tried painting it on with stencils and masking tapes, and while the coverage was better and it didn't peel off as easily, it looked like paint on a print, and I didn't like that, it's the wrong texture. So I figured out a solution with Ravage. Bit of both. I did undercoats of like a greyish white mix on all the parts that I wanted the label to be on, and then I would get a thin layer of masking tape and put it over the top. The masking tape sticks better, it's got the right texture, the basically right color from the get-go that I wanted, and it's slightly transparent so the undercoats show through. So I could just stick it on, cut it to size, and it would look exactly how I wanted. Only thing I had to make sure is that the almost sort of grain lines that the masking tape has was the same direction on all the pieces. Otherwise, it was gonna look hodgepodge. That's something I'm learning as a model maker, is that things need to have the correct texture for it to be believable. So using something that looks like a sticker from the get-go just saves me an awful lot of time trying to fake a sticker. Finally, I did a quick weathering pass. I want him to look like he's a little bit scuffed, like he's a tape that's been left in a drawer for a while, but not so much like a Decepticon warrior that's been few too many battles. Now that everything's painted, I'm gonna give it a quick clear coat, and it's time for the final assembly. Or so I thought. From this point on, Ravage decided to be a problem project. The hips of the cat mode were really, really tiny pieces to fit inside the cassette parameters, and they wanted to snap and break over and over. I also forgot about the laws of physics and how two pins can't exist in the same place at the same time. Combine that with a really thin piece crucially connecting his entire neck assembly to the rest of him. Yeah, my poor planning and design ended up coming back to bite me. I spent a few days super gluing the same part over and over again, trying to sand it to get all the tolerances to fit and work just right, trying to super glue pins and bits together to try and figure out a way of salvaging it, but in the end, it was not worth the time, and it was better off just trying to redesign it. So after all that, it was time to once again do a print, a sand, paint, a clear coat, and a final assembly. And despite all of my planning and whatnot, it was still being too fragile. I thought, okay, maybe I could redesign it for a third time, but then I decided, let's let my kitbasher modeling roots come back in to just take over. I omitted some of the articulation I wanted in the hips so that it would be stronger, so they became one single hinge that still lets it transform, but he can't walk around as much anymore. This does mean, unfortunately, I don't have just a single file that I can print off and Ravage just works first try, but I am tempted to do a redesign at some point if there's enough demand, because it doesn't seem like too difficult a job to just translate my kitbash into a new print. But despite paint chipping, parts snapping, tolerances being too weak, tolerances being too tight, having a literal power cut halfway through me trying to work on him, I still managed to push through, and well, do you want to hear how he sounds in tape mode? Let's take a look, shall we? So that is easily the best cassette transformer I have ever made. The sound quality is amazing. The aux cord instead of the actual tape for the components, it just sounds so much better, is so much more reliable, and I'm very happy I've swapped to using those. The only thing that's inconsistent with them is that if they're not glued in perfectly, they won't line up with the tape head and the sound quality's really, really quiet. But when you do it right, it sounds amazing. So I definitely want to make more Cassetticons using these as the internal components. A new Laserbeak, maybe Slugfest, Rumble, but I think there's a superior Decepticon that I want to try making first. Yeah, stay tuned for that. If you want to share this project without having all the behind the scenes waffle, I've made a separate video that's only about a minute and a half long that's just the promo shots, so it's really cool to just send it and get people seeing it. So, if you like what you saw and you want to see more, feel free to subscribe, and I'll catch you next time. Farewell!